Good evening. As you all know, today is one of the saddest days to the Jewish nation. The Nesi'a Torah, the president of the Torah, Gdol HaPoskim of Halacha, passed away today, 93 years old. And as I said in my previous lectures, there are only few more big chachamim left in the world. That's it. By now I assume three or four left. They're all older than 90. We lost Rav Elyashiv a year ago. We lost Rav Ovadia Yosef today. There's few more chachamim. One is 100 years old, one is 90, one is 91. That's it. The next wave of the chachamim, with all due respect, could be very big tzaddikim and big chachamim, but there is a difference between big chacham to a gdol ador, to a big person that is able to answer any question in any topic, any time, anywhere, to know what answer to give each person, to have the siyata dishmaya that they have. The funeral of Rav Ovadia Yosef today is the biggest funeral in Jewish history. Since the time of Moshe Rabbeinu until today, there was no funeral that had more than 1 million people. In a country of 7 million people, 1 million people went to the funeral, and the others that wanted to go just couldn't make it because Jerusalem was blocked. It took hours just to enter the city. It just couldn't enter. The whole city, every one of the blocks, was all packed with people, religious, not religious, all kinds of people that you would not believe, they came to pay respect. The Gemara say that one of the things that would happen before the Mashiach come is that the Chachamim will not be left. No more Chachamim, that's it. Once the Chachamim are gone from the world, then Ben David would come. And Ben David ba, ad shelo yichlu Chachamim in ador. When the Chachamim are gone, the Mashiach would come. So maybe after all this agony, and more than 1 million people were crying, screaming today, maybe we finally will be able, after all this suffering, to finally have the salvation and the resurrection of the dead, and soon we'll see him back. That's the only comfort we can think about. When somebody like this passed away, everyone has to rip his clothes. It's not just a regular chacham. I'm going to tell you briefly some of the halachot. When a person, chas v'shalom, his father, his mother, they passed away, so you know, we know all the laws of mourning. He has to rip and everything. If his rabbi passed away, rabbi that taught him Torah, or the president of the generation, or Av Beit Din, the chief of the Jewish court, or a huge amount of people who died in a tragedy, or someone, chas v'shalom, who cares God, God forbid, or a Sefer Torah that got burned, or this, or the Beit HaMikdash in Jerusalem, which is burning, or the entire city of Yerushalayim is burning, all this require people to rip their shirts, no music, no nothing, until the body is buried. The side of the heart, all the way down to the heart. Rabbi Ovadia Yosef went to Eretz Israel from Baghdad. He was born in Baghdad in Iraq. 93 years ago, in a generation there was lots of big rabbis, big Kabbalists, very holy people. It was right after the time of the Ben Ish Chai, which was the chief rabbi of Baghdad. And he came to Eretz Israel when he was 4 years old. And at 8 years old, he already wrote his first book. 8 years old, when today little kids don't even know how to read Hebrew. He was already writing books. All his life, he never wasted a moment on nonsense. Never. He was always learning Torah. In yeshiva, when everyone wanted to play ball games, he always learned in recess. He always convinced other people to stay. His love for the Torah is beyond words. Words cannot describe the addiction that he had to God's Torah. It was so big, the love that he had for the Torah, that it's hard to know, thank you, it's hard to know who did he love more, God himself or God's Torah. The love for the Torah is so big. You ask a regular person, we all love the Torah. We enjoy learning Torah. We enjoy listening to Torah. But if somebody asks you, who do you love more? You love the Torah of God or you love God? Of course I love Hashem more. Ma. Love the Torah, I love God. Ma. But some people already reach the level of love to the Torah that you're not sure what's the answer going to be. The Gaon Mivilna was like this. Could not stop 1 minute. In Tisha B'Av, when everyone stopped to learn, they called him learning. So they told him, well, you don't know, you're not allowed to, Rabbi, you don't know, you're not allowed to learn Torah on Tisha B'Av. So his answer was, I know I'm going to be burned in hell for this, but it's worth it for me. It's worth it for me to get burned. Why? That I won't lose a day of learning. That's already, you know, that's beyond humanity. When Rav Ovadia Yosef was a teenager, he broke his two legs and ended up in a hospital with two broken legs. What got him to break his legs? Since he wasn't exactly an athlete, he didn't waste time on this. How a person break both of his legs? He climbed on a ladder to find books in a top shelf, and he was so into the book that he forgot he's standing on the ladder after half an hour that he was so deep in the learning, standing on the ladder. So he closed the book and started to walk, and he fell from the ladder. And it's not a joke. He fell from the ladder and broke his two legs. So the chief Ashkenazi rabbi, which was an older person in his 70s, he went to visit him in a hospital. They asked him, Rabbi, you have time to go visit a teenager that broke his legs? He said, that's not just a teenager. That's going to be the biggest rabbi in the world. How do you know? Say, if a person stands on a ladder and he is so deep into the Torah that he forgets he's standing on a ladder, then you know it's not just a person. It's already a different league. He was right. When he was 18 years old, big rabbis in Jerusalem were rising when he entered the room. They already knew. They saw what's growing here. He altogether published more than 50 books. Thanks to him, all the widows of all the soldiers in the Yom Kippur War were able to get married. No rabbi in the world had the guts and the courage to allow the agunot, women that their husband is missing in a war. Usually you cannot get married until you find a body. But with his brilliance in Torah and knowledge, he found all the ways legally according to the Torah to allow all these widows to get married. Also, thanks to his courage and knowledge, he is the one who, thanks to him, they brought all the Ethiopian Jews from Ethiopia. Nobody knew if they're Jewish or not. There's a lot of arguments about it, if they are, if they're not, if some of them are. And based on his psak halacha that he said 100% Jewish, the Israeli government sent airplanes and got all of them and they brought them to Israel. When he was in his 20s, he was already the chief rabbi of Egypt. In the time that we were in war with Egypt, he was already the chief rabbi in Egypt. And in Egypt, there's a place called the Gniza. Gniza means all the old ancient books from the history that you put them, it's like a museum. You know, it's all very old, broken to pieces, pages from old books from hundreds of years ago. It's like a museum, like a library. It's called the Gniza shel Kair in Cairo. They don't let anyone touch it. You can only see it, but you cannot touch it or take it out. So his memory is something that got him a name, that he has a photographic memory. Everything he sees, he remembers. It got to a point that they made a joke in Israel that someone came to him and asked him, Rabbi, they say you know half of the Torah by heart. So he said, they say you know the whole Torah by heart. So he said, no, don't exaggerate it, only half. So the person asked him, which half? He said, whichever one you choose. That's a joke that they tell about him. Whether it's true or not doesn't really matter. The fact is that no one tells stories like this about you and I. We know the whole Torah by heart, word by word, and all the Talmud. So he used to go to the Gniza in Cairo, read a few pages, go home and write it word by word from his memory. That's how he got books from Egypt that no one in the world has, in handwriting. Brought them to Israel and later they printed them. In his house, they say he has 70,000 books. And he knew always every book where it is, what shelf, what room, what level. He got to a point that I have a friend, his last name is Navarro. He one time went to get a blessing from him. So he asked him, what's your name? He said, Navarro. He said, oh, who heard about Rabbi Navarro? You know, 100 years ago, whatever. Oh, your grandfather was from Turkey, from Izmir. Go to that room, shelf number, whatever, 5, 7 book from the right, your grandfather's book, go bring it. They made a show about him about 3-4 years ago, secular people. He followed his life, his schedule. And there was a professor, secular professor, that they interviewed, and he said that he used to come to him with his work. He was a professor for Tanakh. He used to go with him, so the professor was holding the book, and the professor was reading from the book, and he was correcting him. He was sitting without the book. Every time he made a mistake, he corrected him. This is the level of a chacham we lost. Not only that, before he became technically the chief rabbi of the Sephardim Jews all over the world, which basically was 40 years ago, 40 years he led all the Middle Eastern and the Sephardic Jews in the world, and some Ashkenazim also follow his Piskei Halachot, but mainly all the Sephardim all over the world, unanimously. It was well known that he's Posek Ador, at least for all the Sephardim in the world, hundreds of thousands of people. Before he became the chief rabbi, the Sephardim really didn't have anything in the world. They had little few communities in the world. That's it. The Ashkenazim had already hundreds of years of yeshivot in Europe, tradition, many chachamim. They were well established. They had the Mir Yeshiva, the Lakewood Yeshiva, big yeshivot. So they were well established financially and Torah-wise. But Sephardim were scattered, almost nothing. He is the one who made the revolution in the Sephardi world, that thanks to him in every city in Israel today. You have tens of yeshivots for Sephardim, for Baalei Tshuva, hundreds of mikvehs, thousands of synagogues, hundreds of millions of dollars went to the yeshivot thanks to him. There's no words to describe the achievement that a person had in one lifetime. I doubted if in a history we had one person in a Jewish world that made such an impact on the Jewish nation like him since Moshe Rabbeinu. And it's not an exaggeration. There's always big chachamim. But in the time of the Rambam and other chachamim, if they wanted to achieve impact on the entire world like he had, it would be 100 times harder because there was no media, no printings. You couldn't find the books everywhere. It was all handwriting. So only very few had their books. Nobody knew how they look. Only very few knew what they said. It was in different country. There was no radio, no ways to transfer information, no telephone, no internet, no nothing. So in order for you to reach such an impact, you needed to live 1,000 years. to achieve the same amount of achievements that he had. So Mishalayim, he had the merit that in his generation, Hashem made technology so advanced that basically there's almost no house in the world that these books are not there. Many years ago, I used to give lectures in a real estate office in Queens. Young Israeli people were working in the office. And I used to show them proofs that the Torah is divine. And slowly, slowly, one after the other became Shomer Shabbat. The girls started to wear skirts. The guys got filin. They started to pray Mincha and Arvit in the office. Mamash, the office became like a shul. It was all of a sudden a Jewish atmosphere. So we decided that now when they're more serious in religion, let's do a Shabbaton in my house. I'll invite all of them. We'll make them Shabbat. So there was one girl over there. You know, she's academic from the university with degrees. She's harder to change than others. The other one's already in, but she was, in one hand, she's impressed from the scientific proofs. On the other hand, she's not really so enthusiastic about changing her life, becoming a religious girl. So when she heard everyone comes for Shabbat, she was very curious to know what Shabbat is, because you know, she never saw Shabbat in her life. So they all came to my house. Friday night, we were sitting on a table. For about 2-3 hours, we speak. And then I mentioned something in the name of Rav Ovadia Yosef. When she heard that, she was brainwashed severely by some secular anti-religion media in Israel, which they smash and bash every chacham that they know, mainly him, because he was the most successful and the most famous and all over the news, and also is in charge of Shas, which is the political party of the religious people of the Sfaradim. It was a real target in a secular anti-religion media. So when she heard me saying his name, almost her eyes came out. So she said to me, "This is your hero?" She lost all the respect she had for me. She had a lot of respect for me because she came to a lot of scientific lectures. I spoke her language, you know, she's from the university. But all of a sudden I mentioned someone that in her eyes was from the old primitive days. What someone like me has to do with him? She did not understand how can it be. So she got very upset or sad. So she said to me, "I didn't expect you. I thought you're different." And this was the conversation in front of all the people. So I told her, "What's the problem?" She said, "No, you know," she started to say all the things that she heard on the media. So I told her, I asked her a question. I told her, "Who is the smartest secular person that you admire the most in the world?" So she told me, "Professor Barak, the head of the Supreme Court in Israel." Professor Aaron Barak, he was a professor in Harvard, teaching law, Israeli professor. So I said to her, "Oh, very good. Let me ask you a question," I told her. If I ask him a question about two neighbors who had a fence between their property that broke, and they're fighting who's going to pay for the fence, there's a lot of legal issues here now. Would he be able to tell me the history of this question in all the courts all over the world for the last 1,000 years? She said, "No. Why is he supposed to know all the history of this question? For that, you have archives. You go, there are books, you take the books and you read. There's history about these subjects. Today it's all computerized." So I say to her, come, I want to show you something. She was sitting on the other side of the room. So next to me there was all the books. So I told her, "You see all these books over here? That's the books of Rav Ovadia Yosef. Pull anyone you want out. The name of the series, it's called Yecheve Da'at. One of many books he wrote." So she pulled the book. I say to her, "Open anywhere you want." So she opened. It was questions and answers. So I said to her, "You see this book? Many years ago, 30, 40 years ago, when he was in his 50s, he used to sit in a radio station live. There was only two stations in Israel, Reshet Aleph, Reshet Bet. That's it, very primitive days. No televisions, just radio, primitive radio. Every Friday, there was 1 hour Torah show on the radio in a secular station. Today, you cannot have such thing. You need, in order for you to hear Torah, you need to have a religious station. In a secular 1 hour of Torah, you know if they'll allow it, the Mashiach would come an hour later. So I say people used to call live and ask the hardest question in Judaism, the hardest, about brain surgeons, about illegal boys, illegitimate boys, wars, agunot, heart implant, transplant, the hardest questions. You have to be a brilliant person to know how to bring proofs from previous books and put a case together to allow it or not to allow it. So people ask questions spontaneously. He didn't know the questions. People were calling live. And they recorded the answers. And years later, they published the book. Based on what they recorded him, they wrote it in a book. And the host, every 10, 20 minutes, he used to come on a mic and say, ladies and gentlemen, I want everyone to understand this is a live show. Anyone can call with any question you want. The rabbi doesn't have any books here. It's all live. You can call right now. I give the telephone number, and that's how it was. So I told her, here, you open in a question if a Jew allowed to step in the land of Egypt. That's the question she opened. It was after the Sadat came from Egypt to meet Begin, and now the Israeli newspapers wanted to go to Egypt. One of them was religious. He knew the Torah said that after we came out of Egypt, Lo tashuv lirotam, you're not going to see them ever again, Hashem said. So there was a lot of dilemmas here. First, maybe Hashem meant only the generation of Paro. The generation of Paro are destroyed. It's now Arabs over there, different nation. Maybe Hashem only spoke to the generation who came out of Egypt, but the next generation, it's no problem to go to Egypt. Maybe Hashem say not to move to live in Egypt, but to go visit, it's no problem. There's a lot of questions. Lots of questions. It's not such a simple question. Very complicated question to find a proof if a Jew is allowed to visit in Egypt or not. So I told her, let's go together and read his answers. You ready? So we started. I said to her, every time you see parentheses, that's a quote from one of the books that he brought from different rabbis in the last 1,000 years. Let's count together how many sources he brought for one question from his head with no books. There was no computers in those days, so nobody can suspect he had a search engine or anything like that. It was all in the head with pages, with names of the rabbis, and also, by the way, when he was bringing a source from 800 years ago from some rabbi who went from Iraq to Italy, he also, by the way, told you his life story. When he arrived to Italy, what happened over there, they didn't have Talmud, and they had to go, and one rabbi wrote it, and he tells you the whole story, by the way. So we started to count. After we counted 50 sources, I said to her, you see, there's still 10 more pages to go. So maybe there's 150 sources he brought in one question, and there are thousands of questions over here, and all the answers were all by heart, and that's only 1% of what he know. Many other things that the whole Torah, the Chumash, Rashi, the whole Gemara, the Talmud, the Yerushalmi, the Zohar. I will never forget her face. If you ever, you know, the Gemara say, if you embarrass a person in public, it's like you murdered him. That day I understood 100% what it means to embarrass a person in public. I never had intention to embarrass her. Just wanted to correct her mistake. But you should see her face when she saw that a minute ago, she just said, this is your hero? Oh, she was brainwashed from the anti-religion media. When she saw the power of his brain, of who he was, this is what she said. She put her hand on her heart, and she said in Hebrew, Ani kol kach mitbayeshet. I'm so ashamed. I didn't know. I mean, all I heard was negative on the media. How can it be? It's not human, she says. Oh, now you understand why religious people, why today, it's needless to say, you see how many people were crying and screaming, and for 2 weeks everyone was hoping and praying. We see what's happening. The hospital was packed. Even the secular doctors were crying. to get emotions from the Israeli doctors that see people dying every hour for 30 years, all the cardiologists, it doesn't really happen. The president of Israel, a secular Shimon Peres, cried nonstop today. He wrote a letter. What's the difference between Shimon Peres to other secular people in Israel? He is from the previous generation because he's over 90 years old. So he's a man of a book. He read thousands of books in his life. He loved to read. He read a lot. He has a lot of knowledge from all kinds of things, academics. So somebody who knows a lot and he reads a lot, even if what he reads is nonsense, but he knows to appreciate a person that likes to learn. So he wrote today that Rav Ovadia was a perfect example of what the Torah meant, that a person should not waste a minute of his life. Every day he was sandak in a brit, in his house, he has a shul in his house. Every day there was one or two or more sandakuyot, people bring their babies. The only way he agreed to be sandak, if they bring the baby to his house, because he doesn't want to waste time. And the brit was exactly 5 minutes. Brit milah, that it take us 3 hours, 5 minutes. Quick, bring the baby, one right after the prayers. Still the talit and the tefillin. The moel, 1, 2, 3, and he goes right into his room full of books, sitting and learning. Few times, the prime ministers of Israel entered the room and stood half an hour in a room. And he did not acknowledge him in his room. He didn't pay attention that the prime minister of Israel standing half an hour with people in a room. Because he was so deep in his learning, the prime minister didn't know where to hide from the embarrassment. But later they all learned that it's, God forbid, nothing intentional, that he's really not in this world when he learned. This is an example for all of us. Baruch Hashem, in this generation, there are a few young guys in their 20s, some of them Baalei Tshuva, that also go in this direction. The only problem is we don't have now 60, 70 years to wait until they become him. That's the only problem. If they start 40 years ago, no, at least we had someone to get to this level. But there are a few who also learn 18 hours a day, don't stop to learn. One of them is a convert, 16 years old. They brought him to Rav Ovadia. He tested him every page, everything he knows, word by word. 16 years old convert. Unbelievable memory. Yesterday, someone sent me an email that he has a son like this. He's wasting his time in yeshiva. For his age, he already knows what people in their 40s knows. Every one of his rabbis said, we never saw, in 40 years we teach, we never saw a boy like this. No matter what, you make a beep, right away understand everything, remember everything, pages, who said what, everything. It's a gift. This is it. We don't know, really we don't know what's going to be. I think it's not an exaggeration to say that the people cry today more than they cried in the entire Yom Kippur of their life, combined. That's how much people cry today. Rivers of tears. Rav Steinman, 100 years old, came to the funeral. All the big chachamim, people, it's hard for them to walk. A million people around you in the heat of Israel, with crowded, come like this, a person 100 years old, all the way from Bnei Brak to Yerushalayim, with traffic and all this headache. So, there's the Gemara says that if a Talmid Chacham doesn't have a respectful eulogy, Chas v'Shalom, all kinds of tragedies can come to the nation of Israel. Over here, we don't have that fear that the eulogy won't be respectful. It will be more than it was ever heard in a history. Hundreds of people gave eulogies all over the world. Like I said, the biggest funeral in Jewish history, I doubted very much if ever it's going to be another funeral with more than a million people participating in it. I doubt it, if it's possible. And you have to know one thing. If the people of America had enough time to get to the funeral, because, you know, they are several hours ahead there, and until you get the flight, it takes about 11, 12 hours to get there, it wouldn't pay, because it would be already after the funeral. If they had enough time, if they announced that they keep the body more than one day, you would have another 300,000-400,000 people that would come from here or from the rest of the world. Because he had many chachamim among the Syrian community, all the people over the years that helped him in everything he did. It's a lot of people. A lot of people would go there. So this is it. I remember one time, he's living in Har Nof in Yerushalayim. So in a place where he lived before, in Israel, when you have a building, so you have someone who is in charge. There's really no board. There's one person who is in charge of the bills of the building, the electric, the cleaning. Everyone pays some kind of a fee to that person, and he takes care of the building, whatever needs to be done. And every once in a while, they elect someone, and he's in charge to decide to paint, not to paint. Okay. So there was one woman in charge in a building, and she was secular, and he lived in that building. So one time she decided to make a tenant meeting to invite all the owners of the apartments to make a decision about something in a building that needs big money. So he sent his assistant, the one who was helping him. So he came instead of him to the meeting. So she said, "Who are you?" He said, "I came in the name of the Rav." The Rav is busy, he's a busy person. Doesn't have time to waste an hour now, sit here in a committee here. So I came for him, whatever I decide is fine. So she said, "No, I'm very sorry. You're not one of the tenants in the building. The rabbi has to come." So he was begging her, "Leave him alone. He's a very busy person. He has lots of things on his mind. Can I waste an hour here?" But she didn't care. She insisted that he'll come. She didn't want to start until he'll come. So when he went down to him, he said, "Okay." He went up, and by the time he finished the meeting, he came down back to his apartment. She became paralyzed in her leg, this woman. It was a published story. She started to scream. She couldn't get up from the chair. And she started to say, "I know that I got punished for what I did to the rabbi," she said. And later, he forgave her, and then she became okay. She went back to, she had a temporary mamash like this, clear miracle. But the biggest thing I heard was, after the Yom Kippur War, when there were so many widows who do not know now if they'll ever be able to get married, because their husbands are missing. Either they died, nobody knows what happened to them. So he was giving permissions to, based on testimonies of soldiers and what happened in a battle, he was giving to some of these ladies permission that they're able to get married. It's a huge risk, huge risk. If you give a woman a note with the stamp of the Jewish court, and you are the rabbis who allow her to go and get married. She was a married woman and her husband disappeared. And nobody knows where he is. And he didn't give her a get. So now there is a huge risk that a year or two later he'll show up. Maybe he was a prisoner. Maybe they captured him something. Maybe the people who say they saw him died. Maybe they made a mistake. It's very difficult. Even if you have witness, one witness, two witnesses, people say, "Oh, we saw him in a building and the building exploded, a bomb fell, and the whole building smashed to pieces." So 99% he died. But maybe not. Maybe he became paralyzed, and 2 days later they found him. It's a big risk here. So there was one reporter in the Israeli secular newspaper, the woman, she wanted to get a scoop. So she came to him pretending she's one of these widows. After Yom Kippur, it was 40 years ago, so he was by then 52 years old. She came to him, and she said, "My husband, this, that." She set up the whole thing. She brought people, they claimed they saw her husband. Everything from the beginning to the end was a lie. And he gave her a note that she's able to get married, and her husband is alive working with her in a newspaper. And he just gave her a note in her hand. And she said, "That's it. That's the end of his career. As soon as I walk out of this door, I put it in the Israeli secular newspaper, he won't ever be able to be a rabbi for the rest of his life. It's finished." So she walked out of the door. There was no cellular phone. There was rotary phones, if you remember, in the old days. So she went to a payphone. She put some money in her payphone. She called up the office of the newspaper, asking for her husband. So when she called, somebody picked up the phone, and she said, "Where is my husband?" And that person started to cry. He said, "A few minutes ago, we just were announced that he had a critical car accident, and he died instantly." As soon as he gave her the note in her hand that she's permitted to get married, Hashem killed her husband. That the Chacham won't have this embarrassment. No joke here. And that was, to the best of my knowledge, maybe the most famous miracle that I know. I mean, there are many, there's books about things that happened in his lifetime. But this is it. There are stories like this about Rav Moshe Feinstein also. That a woman came to him and she said, "You gave me permission to get married." And he said, "It cannot be." She said, "Here is your signature." He looks at his eyes, he says, "It's not, cannot be, I never." So later she admitted that it's all forged. So his assistant asked him, "Rabbi, how do you know? You have hundreds of people coming to you every week and she comes after a few years. How did you know that it's not your signature?" He told him, "It cannot be that I give my life for the nation of Israel and Hashem will do such a thing to me." Why? He knew that he's 100% tzaddik, clean, perfect, pure, not for money, not for politics, just to serve the people for the sake of heaven. What's God's incentive? That people would lose their faith in a rabbinical authority? Would be a disaster. Disaster. Imagine Moshe Rabbeinu tell the nation of Israel, "Go, we have to go and do this and this and that," and they all get killed. Or thousands of them get killed based on the instruction of Moshe. Who would follow him after that? Who can trust what he says? He comes to speak in the name of Hashem. He defeated his entire purpose. Like I say, today, the only comfort that you can we can have right now, since we don't have anyone that can inherit him and be in his level, besides few Ashkenazi rabbis, which they're all very old, as I said before, I don't really know what's going to happen, because if the world won't have, in few years, Chas v'Shalom, won't have any big giant Chacham like we always had, from the entire generations until now, we always had very big Chachamim. If Chas v'Shalom, nobody would be left, I don't really know how our future is going to be, because you have to understand, it's not, we're not talking about being a judge, being a prime minister or something like that, that you can elect anyone. You can be a postman and tomorrow is the leader. You can be a movie star and tomorrow is the president of the United States, surrounded by advisors. It's not the same. It means the entire spiritual future and political future of the nation is on his shoulders. It's not a joke. I'll give you an example. Right now, everyone was panicking in Israel that Assad will shoot chemical weapon in Israel. What was the odds, the chance that he will do it? About 50%, because he have nothing to lose. Now he got out of his problem between America and Russia. Somehow they kept him in power. But it was moments before losing his chair, and as a last act of suicide, he would shoot his chemical arsenal. He can shoot 100 missiles to Israel with all kinds of gas, kill 1,000 Chas v'Shalom of Jews, and stay a hero in a Muslim world for eternity. Since anyway he knows he's going to die, his nation hates him, he killed 100,000 of his own people, so the only thing could have saved his reputation in any way if he take 100,000 Jews with him to the grave. Then he become what they call a shahid. There was a big panic in Israel, believe me. Even though they don't run in the media and they make everyone in panic, they were shaking. Because you saw that even the Hezbollah shot missiles and the Hamas shoot rockets, and we don't have the answers to it. Can't stop it. They can put us out of business. With a rocket that costs $500, the entire city is in a shelter. $500 they shoot. Everyone is hiding in a shelter for 3 days. A chemical weapon, you know what it is? A missile falls in Tel Aviv, and in 5-10 blocks, everyone's breathing gas and they can't breathe and they're tearing to death. So they were very scared. So all the people in Bnei Brak, I believe in Bnei Brak you have more than 100,000 religious people. Most of them learning Torah all day. They came to Rav Chaim Kanievsky. He's one of the top three chief Ashkenazi rabbis in the world. They told him, Rabbi, do we need a gas mask? He answered, what is it, Purim? In Purim, you need mask. Now, you sit and learn Torah and don't worry about it. You know what the risk it is, what he did? In a billion years, anybody else would be scared to answer this question. Why would I take such a risk? Of course, go get a mask. Stand 6 hours online and get a mask. What? I need on my conscience that tomorrow, Chas v'Shalom, 1,000, 2,000 people would choke to death and everyone would remember in history that I gave the instructions? What courage. Nobody needs to waste time on standing online. Nobody needs a mask. And it's not the first time. Also with Saddam Hussein, the same thing. They ask him, do we need mask? No one in Bnei Brak will get hurt. So Rabbi, are you sure? He said, no missile will fall in Bnei Brak. No missile will fall. One missile fell one block away from the border of Bnei Brak in Ramat Gan and caused the biggest damage. Whole building collapsed in Ramat Gan. In Bnei Brak, no missile fell. Never a missile fell in Yerushalayim or in Bnei Brak. Haifa, Bat Yam, Rishon, Be'er Sheva, Ashkelon, Ashdod, all the way in the north, plenty. Yerushalayim and Bnei Brak, the center of the Torah protected. The Chinese in Shanghai, in a war, they put their missile around the Mir Yeshiva. Mir Yeshiva, all around it is Chinese missiles. In a war. They asked them, why are you putting the missiles here? He said, over here, your God protecting you. We want to be protected. The Chinese knew it. When Rabbi Ovadia Yosef was in Egypt, he wrote a letter that the shochet in town, the one who sells the meat, is not a kosher person. No one is allowed to buy meat from him. He put him on a ban. Of course, he lost his parnasai. Cannot make money now. He came to his office, to his home, in Egypt, with a gun to his head. And he said to him, if you don't give me a different letter now, I kill you right now. He didn't move. He said, kill me. I'm not going to be the reason people would eat non-kosher meat. That story did not end. Many years later, when he went back to Israel, again he came to his house. When he was the Dayan in Petach Tikva, again he tried to kill him. And Hashem saved him again from that Rasha. They asked him, you're not afraid? He said, when you do L'Shem Shammai, you do for the sake of heaven, that's it. You don't have to calculate what's going to happen to me. It's not about me. I have a job, I must do it. The halacha is Chacham Shemet. A Talmid Chacham, a Torah scholar, big one, that dies, passed away. Besides his relatives, everyone ripped their shirt up to their heart. The yeshiva of that Chacham, all 7 days mourned for him. When is the time that they have to rip their shirt? When the rumor is published that they saying now the eulogy, then that's what the entire nation is doing it. A president of the generation, president of the Torah, Akol Korim Alav, everyone, the entire nation. Vechol Batei Midrashot Betelin, all the yeshivot closed their doors to go to his funeral. They may say, why? To learn Torah is much more important mitzvah than to go to a funeral. So we learn for his neshama. It's a good point, no? Wow, all of us will close all 10 hours, we learn Torah, 5,000 students in Emir Yeshiva. Everyone's going to close now the Gemara and go to the funeral. So you had a way to say, well, it's 1 billion mitzvot to do 5,000 mitzvot. Each one does mitzvah of Kvod HaMet or Kvod HaChacham. But you lose a billion mitzvot, 5,000 students. 10 hours a day, because the entire funeral, to get there until it finished, all the eulogies, you lose a billion mitzvot, and you make 5,000 mitzvot. Who say Hashem wants it? So that's why you need Torah, to tell you what to do. So the Torah says you close all the yeshivot, and all the synagogues. Nobody walks in the market, no one goes shopping. All the stores close, everything. Every family sits sad and mourn. Nesi Ador. Today there's no official job as Nesi Ador. Baruch Hashem, like I said, a few Gdolei Ador. Rav Ovadia Yosef was the president of Chochmei Moetzet HaTorah. All the chief rabbis, he was the president of the committee of the chief rabbis. In the time of the Gemara, there was Rabbi Yehuda Nasi. He was Nasi, he was also like the prime minister. Like today we have a prime minister. Today, a prime minister can be someone who doesn't even know how to read Hebrew, or to write Hebrew, or he doesn't know how to read one Mishnah, or he never heard of any Torah in his life. He can be a prime minister. But in the old days, if you're not big authority in Torah, no, you can never be a president. You have to be somebody, one of the biggest chachamim in the world, in order for you to be the president of Israel. So that's what they're talking here about. We saw 2 days ago in Parashat Noach that the parasha is speaking about two generations of wicked people, but different kinds of wicked problems. First generation is the generation that Hashem drowned to death, all of them, did not leave one survivor from them besides Noach and his family. That's called Dor HaMabul, the generation of the flood. When was the flood? Who knows? How many years ago? 4,200 years ago. That's why there's a tree in a museum in Manhattan that has 4,200 circles. Every year the tree has a new circle, every year. So the more circles the tree has, the more years this tree exists. The oldest tree that they found is a big tree. It's like almost the size of a whole room, standing like this. I remember maybe 15 years ago I saw it. It was from the time of the flood. Why? Because before the flood destroyed the whole world. 1,500 years after the creation of the world, Hashem restarted the world by drowning the world in water, like mikveh, natural water, purify everything, even a pot that you buy from a goy, you need to put it in a mikveh. You put it in and out, you make it pure. See, the natural water has a power, as the Torah said, that the water has to gather in a pit, naturally, either spring water, or lake, or rivers, or ocean, and definitely rainwater, that's it. But if you bring water from one place to another, that's it. They didn't come there naturally. How they do the mikveh today? When women go to the mikveh inside buildings, fancy, $5 million building. What natural about it? The answer here, on the roof, all the water who rains, it goes, there's some places there's no rain, like in Arizona. It's very difficult to have a mikveh there. You sometimes need to wait months until you have one or two rains over there to fill up the place. It may take you a long, long time. So sometimes, there's other ways. They bring ice, they bring snow. It's a question what's allowed, what's not allowed. But to bring water is not allowed. So the Torah says that there was, in this parasha, two different generations. The generation of the Mabul and the generation of the Babylonian Tower. Who knows what's the difference between the first disaster to the second disaster? The parasha starts, very interesting. Every word in the Torah has a deep meaning. If a person doesn't pay attention, he may miss the entire understanding of the entire chapter. This is how the parasha starts. Ele toldot Noach. This is the descendants of Noach. Noach, ish tzadik tamim, haya bedorotav. Noach was a righteous person, tamim, means complete, in his generations. Not generation, generations. Why? He lived very long life. More than one generation. Et ha'elokim italech Noach is a follower of Hashem. He listens to God. There's no Torah yet. This is 900 years approximately before the Torah was given. Right? 4,200 years ago. That's the time of the flood. The Torah is about 3,300 years ago. So it's 900 years before the Torah was given. When Adam was created, Hashem gave him 6 laws. When Noah came to the world, after the flood, Hashem added one more law to the 6, which called Ever Min Achai, not to eat the animals unless you kill them first. Sometimes people eating them, while they're eating them, they're killing them. That was a habit in those days. Today it sounds very primitive, very foolish. But that was the way it was. So Hashem said, no one is allowed to eat anything before it's completely dead. Only when the nefesh of the animal came out, the animal is completely dead, you're allowed to eat it. The goyim, they can eat a dead animals. It's called nevela. An animal died, the goy can take it and barbecue it. Let's say a goat just hit by a lightning and it fell on the floor dead. The goy can take it, cut it to pieces, and make grill. What's the problem? It just died a minute ago. When I slaughter it, it's not the same. The goy think, what's the difference? They go and they shoot deers. Sometimes I come from upstate, I see they have deers on the van. You know, where is they just hunt them. They have places they can hunt deer. What are they going to do with this deer? Hang it in their store? Maybe the head. But the body, they eat. They eat the body. But it's nevela. Deer, it's kosher. But if a Jew eat this deer, sin from the Torah. If the deer was slaughtered in a kosher way, yeah. But it's almost impossible to find deer meat. Why? Because it's very difficult to catch them. They're very quick, and they run. It's not like the goat, the cow. You come, you give her one smack, move here. Die, 1, 2, 3, and you have steaks. The deer, it's very difficult. I remember one time we had a guy, a Baal Tshuva in Monsi. A guy from Israel. Since he's a kid, he was always into animals. Catching animals, having snakes, having parrots, birds. You know, some kids, horses, always into animals. One time, you know, in Monsi, there's lots of deers. You come in your backyard almost every night. When I come home, I see the deers in my backyard, a few of them. So he caught one and put it in a car. And he wanted to bring it to a shochet in Monsi, that he will slaughter it, that everyone will taste finally once what a deer meat tastes. Guess what happened? The deer got a heart attack in the car and died. So you see from here, it's not a good idea to go after deers. If you finally catch them, they die to you anyway. That's why you don't find it. There's one restaurant in Manhattan, I heard that you can get deer meat, $300 a plate or something like that. If you're curious. Also bison. Bison is also kosher. Also giraffe. Did you ever hear about a restaurant who sells giraffe steaks? No, right? Why not? What's the difference, giraffe or a cow? This is an animal, and this is an animal. Why nobody eats giraffes? One giraffe is lots of meat.
You never knew they have a restaurant for that thing, they sell giraffes.
What's the tradition, how to slaughter it?
That's why I'm asking. Deer, there is one restaurant in New York that sells deer. It's in Upper West Side. I'm asking, why you never heard in the world of any place that you can get giraffe meat? You know, the rich people, out of curiosity, we have to try at least once a giraffe, no? We tried bison, we tried deer, we tried goats, we tried cows, we try everything. We have to try giraffe, no? Yeah. How can we die without tasting a giraffe steak? So why the rich people are not after giraffe meat? Even grasshoppers they ate. You know, the Yemenite, they didn't have French fries. Their French fries was grasshoppers. Yeah, why? Because there was a wave of millions of grasshoppers all over the house, this. So all they do is just catch them. They see in the stomach, they know how to tell which one is kosher, which one is not. There's a sign on the stomach, like a chet, a shape of the letter chet. They know which one is kosher, which one is not. And they fry them in a pan. There was huge poverty in Yemen. That's why the Yemenite food, it's all dough. All water and flour, nothing else. Jachnun, water and flour. Malawach, water and flour. Lachuch, water and flour. All their food. They finally have a Yemenite meat, Yemenite soup, marak temani. You ask them what's in it. They say meat. You come, you see a piece of bone. The leg of the cow. That's it. That's how it, why it was poverty. There's no money. Who could afford it? They lived in very, very poor environment. That's why, by the way, in Yemen, there was never one Jew was violating Shabbat in the history of Yemen. There's not one country in the world that can say, in our land, the Jewish community never had a Mechalel Shabbos. Can say it in Russia, can say it in Poland, can say it in Germany. You can say it anywhere in the world. There's only one place that you can come and say, by us, not even one time, 2,600 years, not even one Jew violated Shabbat in public. That you can point at him and say, hey, look what he does. He rides on a donkey on Shabbat. No cars. Rides on a donkey. That's Mechalel Shabbat. Riding, Mechalel Shabbat. Smoking, Mechalel Shabbat. Never in the history of Yemen. Why? Being primitive, it's the best gift. iPhone, computer, this, science, and everyone forgot Hashem. What's better? To have all the advanced equipment and forget Hashem and have no share to the life of eternity? Or to stay primitive, Saadia, primitive, you know, in his corner, and then he goes to heaven and laugh. Like in Israel, they say, Tzochek mi shetzochek acharon. The Jews with the bow tie in New York, with their Cuban cigar and their Rolls Royce. Mr. Levy, Mr. Horowitz, come, Shomer Shabbat. I'm not sure how many of them made it to heaven. This Saadia, the primitive in Yemen, on a donkey, looks like Arab like this. Many of them are in heaven. Why? They had no opportunity to sin. You know, if you ever want to buy etrog in Sukkot, you should buy a Yemenite etrog. Any other etrog, it's a doubt if it's an etrog or it's mixed with lemon. Anyone. Why? It went through so many journeys and they mixed, the farmers genetically mixed the seeds. Why they mix it? If you grow only etrog trees, many of them goes to a waste. Very difficult to grow it because it's a very sensitive Gentile fruit. So you can invest a lot of time and money and in the end you don't have that much products. But if you mix it with lemon, lemons is tolerating the weather, no problem. By etrog, if a leaf, there's wind, a leaf falls from the tree and hit the fruit, it's already make a mark on the fruit. But lemon is not like that. So the farmers, the goyim, what do they care about the Jews? They want to sell. Want it to be beautiful, nice, yellow, good shape. And the more you have, the more money you make. So they mixed all of them with lemon seeds. Very difficult to know. In my opinion, it's almost impossible to find a etrog that it's kosher unless if it's Yemenite. Every etrog that I open in my life, everyone with no exception, after Sukkot that was not Yemenite, was lemon inside. All of them, with the best hashgachot, very difficult. Mamash lemon inside. But Yemenite is different. Different shape, nothing like lemon inside. Why is it? Because the Yemenite farmers are so primitive, they didn't know how genetically to mix the seeds. That's the reason, that's it. Everyone wonder, why Yemenite? It also costs more than double or triple on the price to get a good one. Why? They just don't know. Even today, you go to Yemen, you ask the farmer, hey, Muhammad, come here. He doesn't know. Why? They still live like 1,000 years ago in most places over there. Being modern, it's not always a privilege. Most of the time it's a destruction. That's what they say in Israel. Tzochek mi shetzochek acharon. Someone who laughs in the middle of the battle, it's nothing. We only care who laughs after the last ring. Who laughs in the first round, second, third, fifth, doesn't matter. After 12 rounds, look who's laughing. That's all we want to know. Why do we care? He laughs in the first, second, third. Nobody would remember this. So it says like this. Why the Torah say, Noach ish tzadik tamim? What does it mean, tamim, in Hebrew? In modern Hebrew, the word tamim means innocent, naive. But it's of course wrong. Half of the words in modern Hebrew are the opposite of what the ancient Hebrew are. Purposely, the communist Zionist, they modify the ancient holy Hebrew to a new Zionist language in order to plant confusion among the religious Jews. That if a religious Jew would pray to Hashem for one thing, he will get the opposite. Because he doesn't know. He comes to Israel. They teach him now in Israel Hebrew. They took many words from the Gemara and they translated it to Mother Hebrew as the opposite meaning. So you come, you ask Hashem, give me health, chas v'shalom, you ask for death. Give me a wife, chas v'shalom, they give you a husband. You don't know. They don't know the words. They mix it. How do I know it? I didn't know it until 6-7 years ago. One Satmer Hasid wrote a book. That was one of the shocks I ever got. Really had no idea about it. I never suspect that they did it on purpose. Tell me, they're ignorant, they didn't know, they're not religious, they didn't know Gemara, I believe it. Innocent mistakes, thousands of mistakes. What can we do? They messed up the divine language. But he proved in that book that it's not innocent. Why? Because this Eliezer ben Yehuda, how did he know how to translate all these words? He wasn't a religious person. He hired Avrechim, paid the money Avrechim. He had a newspaper, Zionist newspaper in Israel. They put him on a ban, the community in Jerusalem. No one talked to him. No one allowed him anywhere. He had a very difficult life. He did not give up his dream. He wanted to revive the Hebrew language. Why? He saw people speaking Yiddish, and the Sephardim speak Arabic, and the Portuguese from Saloniki and all these people who came from Greece, they speak Ladino, Portuguese, Ladino. See, every neighborhood, different language. You come to Jerusalem, the Bukharians speak Bukharian. You go over here, the Syrians speak Arabic. The Egyptian, Arabic. The Ashkenazim, all of them Yiddish. What's going on? Some speak Russian, some Yiddish. So it cannot go on, a country with so many languages. Has to be a national language. The idea was positive. But what came out of it is not exactly the same. So when you say Noach ish tzadik tamim, it's actually making fun of him in the modern Hebrew. Yeah, tzadik is good. Everyone understands tzadik is righteous. It's the same meaning. But tamim today in Hebrew, in Israel, if you say to some, Eze tamim ata, you saw tamim, means you fool. You're innocent. People fooling you easily. That's what it means. But that's not what it means in the Torah. Tamim in the Torah means complete. Ish tam, Yaakov ish tam, Yoshev Oalim. Complete. But it's actually deeper than that. Let me explain. It says like this. In the beginning, it says, Noach haya tzadik vegam tamim. Tzadik and tamim, two different things. After that, Hashem comes to him. We read in the parasha. Ki otcha ra'iti tzadik lefanai bador hazeh. I saw you righteous in front of me in this generation. What happened to the tamim? No more complete? Complete is a very good compliment. Maybe even higher than tzaddik. So what happened when who gave the Torah? Hashem. It's the same Hashem. Hashem told Moshe write da-da-da-da-da. So when Hashem told Moshe to write Parashat Noach, he told him write tzaddik and tamim. Righteous and complete. But then later, Hashem described what he spoke to Noach. The Tamim got kicked out of the picture. Most people, they can read the parasha 1,000 times. They don't dig. They don't pay attention. But it's very big meaning here. Listen good. So it says like this. The Torah say, Noach ish tzadik tamim bedorotav. In his generations. More than one. Okay. Because Noach lived in two different times. The generation of the flood, the generation of the pelaga. When everyone scattered and split. Okay. The sins of the two generations were completely different. The sin of the people from the flood was ethical, ethic and morality, which means what we call today, averot sheben adam lechavero, sins between men to men, stealing, cheating, lying, lashon hara, insulting, embarrassing, you know, okay. The Dor HaPelaga, the next generation, after they build the tower, they want to go and fight against Hashem. So what is it? They believe there is Hashem. Right? If you tell me now, let's make a tower and go and fight against Muhammad. Muhammad. Who's Muhammad? What do we care about him? Oh, whatever, JC, whatever. We know not to waste a minute on it. But if they build the tower to go and fight against Hashem, what does it tell us? That's what's happening in our generation. Most of the Jews believe in Hashem. But most of them are fighting against him all their life. Well, all their life. How do you know they believe in Hashem? Ask every Chiloni that you know. When he has problems, what did he say in a hospital? God, help me. When the IRS send him a letter and he opens the mailbox, what's the first word come out of his mouth? Oh, no. Oh, God. First thing, he doesn't say, oh, mommy, oh, brother, oh, my son, oh, my partner, oh, Obama, help me. What does he say? The most anti-religion person. Oh, God, in a time of war, what our soldiers were screaming in Lebanon. Some of them became religious, so they said, the most anti-religion soldier, they're screaming, Hashem, help us, Shema Israel. One Rami, he became a rabbi today. He was kibbutznik from the Shomer HaTzair. Never saw in his life page of Torah. When the Arab Ahmed came with a big knife towards him, and his rifle got around, and he couldn't turn the rifle, and he saw this Muhammad come to stick the knife in his heart. He said, I don't know, out of nowhere, I started to scream, Shema Yisrael. Kibbutznik. Don't know where these words came from. So they believe in Hashem, but they want to go and fight against him. The Zohar says when Mashiach comes, the wicked people will gather together to go fight against Hashem. So that's called twisting the real Jewish ideology. That's the difference between the two generations. One generation, morality issues, ethic. People are corrupted. People are bad. People are behaving worse than animals. That's one sin. Like Sodom and Gomorrah. And over here, spiritual conflict, debate. Debate. Okay. In the first generation, what's the opposite of a person who has no morality and no ethic? What's the opposite of him? Tzaddik. Righteous. Righteous. No morality, twist the coin, the other side will be righteous. Corrupted ideology, the opposite is tamim. When Hashem described Noach in the Torah, in the parasha, before the flood, it says, Noach ish tzadik tamim. He has the answer to this kind of wicked people, is the opposite of them, and he also the opposite of this kind of people. But after they all got killed, what happened? Hashem only comes with one title to him. Why? Because the opposite of lack of emunah and faith and confidence is God. In God is to be complete in your faith. That's why only tamim. This parasha is one of the foundations of the laws of ethic and morality in Judaism. Why did Hashem bring the flood? Flood killed millions of people with no mercy. They all drowned to death. Why? For averot ben adam lechavero. For sins that in our eyes are not so bad. Why? I'll give you why. If a person is mechalel Shabbat according to the Torah say you have to execute him. It's a sin between man to God. He's violating the covenant between us and God. The Torah say he has to be put to death by stoning, and I cut his soul from the afterlife. He has no share to the world to come. For what? Violating Shabbat or worshipping an idol. So we see sins between us to Hashem, many of them has an execution punishment. Where did you find in the Torah even once, besides sex crimes, where did you find in the Torah that between man to man there is an execution punishment? If you steal, no execution by the Jewish court. You don't respect your parents, no execution. There are many, many morality issues. Lashon Hara, yes, a horrible sin, but they cannot execute you. Sins between men to men, no execution. Sins between men to Hashem, many of them has execution. So why in that case, Hashem gave a bigger punishment to the people, to the generation who made sins between men to men, and he killed them, and the generation who went to fight against Hashem, which is much worse, he didn't touch them. He made some of them monkeys, and the rest, he confused their languages and scattered them all over the world. That's it. But they stay alive. Oh, okay. So instead of Hebrew, you speak Chinese from now on. A little harder to write with all these pictures. Fine, it's not the end of the world. But over here, what? Everyone died. That's what it means, mal'a ares chamat. Yeah.
Why did Noah curse his grandson but not his son?
Oh, that's a good question he asked. I actually spoke about it yesterday in my lecture in Brooklyn. I'll answer you briefly. When Noah, after the flood, he planted vineyard. And then he made wine. He squeezed the grapes. He made strong wine. He became drunk. He slept naked on his room. In his room. And his son, Ham, the wicked son out of the three, castrated him. What's the right word? Castrated him? He made him unable to have kids. What's the right word? Castrated him. Thank you. Castrated him. This is my English professor. So, not that it helps, you know. But it helps a little bit. So, yeah. So when Noah got up, he said, I have to give you a punishment measure for measure. You made me unable to have a fourth kid. You already have a fourth kid. It's too late for me. If you had three sons, I'll curse you that you can never have another kid. Fine. But since you already have a fourth one, I put the curse on your fourth one, which is Knan. Eved Avadim Yelecha Varur Knan. It becomes a cursed nation. It's not the only nation is cursed. The seven nations that are idols worshippers who sat in the Holy Land when we came from Egypt to occupy Israel, seven nations, Hashem said, they're all cursed. They have no mercy on them, they're all idols worshippers, I'll throw them from the land, they're big sinners, etc. Plus, the Torah teaching us that when he cursed Knan, which is the fourth son of Ham, he is the one who called his father to do it to the grandfather. He told him, look at grandpa, he's naked. By the way, I want to ask you a question. The question that I ask is actually related to your question. Why in Judaism, every mitzvah is with wine? Shabbat, Kiddush, wine. Avdalah, wine. Getting married, wine. Getting divorced, no wine. You want, not only your house is destroyed, you want to make l'chaim? Sometimes it's mitzvah to make l'chaim after. I just got saved from a Gehenom. The Gemara said there are three things to save a person from hell. What are they? Do you know? One of them is a bad wife. That's a replacement from hell. Hashem say, you know, you deserve the worst hell, but you have a free card out of jail. Free out of jail card. Why? 40 years. I have such pity on what you had in your life. Dismissed. It's not a joke. What's the second one? Stomach problems. Everything he eats, stomach problems all the time. And what's the third one? Poverty. But not poverty like today. Every poor person drives a Lexus here in Queens. Real poverty. Poverty like Rabbi Avraham Ibn Ezra. For 3 days he didn't have one slice of bread. One of the legendary rabbis in a history 800 years ago. And for 3 days his stomach is grinding on empty. Not only that. Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul and Rav Ovadia Yosef, when they were young, they're learning Chevruta in Porat Yosef. They didn't have money for the bus. No money for the bus. They had to walk an hour. Rav Ovadia, he wasn't as poor as Rav Ben Zion. Rav Ben Zion Bechlal didn't have a penny. Rav Ovadia, his father, had a little grocery. So a little money they had. So money for the bus, Rav Ovadia had, but Rav Ben Zion didn't have. So they loved the Torah so much, they learned together, Chevruta. So Rav Ovadia was paying for both of them one way, that they go together in a bus and they learn in a bus on the way to Yeshiva. And on the way back home, they walk an hour and learn. Not like us, walk in the street, want a nice building. Oh, they just opened a new store here, let's see what's around. No, I didn't waste a minute. So Rav Ovadia, since he has photographic memory, he would say the whole page by heart. And Rav Ben Zion, which was a very, very sharp, deep brain, started to attack questions, answers, and both of them became the two biggest Sephardi rabbis in the last 100 years. Why? They love to learn. When Rav Ovadia was young, maybe we'll finish with that. We started with him, we'll finish with him. When Rav Ovadia was young, the Jordanians were shooting missiles in Jerusalem. The Western Wall wasn't in our hand yet. It was there in Jordanians' hands. So what they call today East Jerusalem. So they were shooting missiles to the other side. One time on Friday night, there was a curfew. There was British in Israel. So it was all days. So there was curfew. No one was allowed out of their house. So they went to shul Friday night. And after that, the missiles started. Everyone ran home. But he was so into the learning, he was sitting by the women's section. He didn't pay attention. He was learning. And his father, yeah, his father's name was Yaakov. He started to run. The missiles are shooting. The bombs are falling. Everyone is hiding in their homes. And where is my son? Where is Ovadia? He runs. He looks for all over for him. That's it. He was sure something happened to him. After all that, they found him in a shul. He was ready to give him such a smack. So there was another rabbi there that was helping him to look for him. He said, don't you dare raise your hand on this boy. He's going to be the biggest rabbi in the world one day. Don't touch him. You don't hit a boy for learning Torah. His father got a heart attack. His son is missing. Bombs are falling. Everyone hiding at home. Forgot about it. didn't pay attention to what's happening around him. Rav Ovadia Yosef was learning in Porat Yosef. The Rosh Yeshiva was Rabbi Ezra Atiyah. Rabbi Ezra Atiyah, I don't know what was his merit, besides being a complete chacham, a giant chacham. He got the blessing that all the chief Sephardi rabbis in the world came from him, all of them. One yeshiva, all the big chachamim from one yeshiva, and he was the rabbi of Panama, the chief rabbi of Panama, Alav Shalom, Tzion Cohen, Rav Ovadia, Rav Ben Tzion, Rav Ades, all the big chachamim, all the big mekubalim, everyone was his talmidim. Yeshivat Porat Yosef. How Yeshivat Porat Yosef started, you know? In the time of the Ben Ish Chai in Baghdad, more than 100 years ago, there was one rich Iraqi Jew that made a lot of business in India. India was a gold mine in those days, selling textiles, all kinds of things like this. So he came to the Ben Ish Chai, and he say, I have a dream. What's my dream? To open in Israel. There was no state yet. There were some Jews living in Israel. The Arabs are there. The Turkish were there 100 years ago. The Turks, the Ottomani. I want to build a hospital in Israel. There's no hospital. Need hospital. And I have the money. Ben Ish Chai told him, open a yeshiva, don't open a hospital. He came to ask him that he wants to go and build a hospital. He didn't come to ask if to open a hospital or yeshiva. He just wanted to get a bracha that he's going to Israel with the money, so he's a rich man, to open a hospital. There was no hospital. So Ben Ish Chai told him, no, open a yeshiva. So he said, right, Rabbi, I'm coming to give you, to get a bracha from you to open a hospital. You're convincing me to open yeshiva? So Ben Ish Chai told him, hospitals, there will be people standing online to donate money for. The world is full of fools. They don't know the difference between curing the body and curing the soul. 99% of the people, they would invest their money in curing bodies. You don't want your money to cure bodies. You want your money to cure souls. Torah, Yirat Shamayim, Musar, to materialize the ticket for the afterlife, for life of eternity, for Olam Haba. Hospital. No, it's important. How many wicked people come to the hospital? How many anti-God people you have to cure with your money? How many Arabs would come to the hospital that they're fighting and bombing us? What are you going to do? What's happening now in the hospitals in Israel? 50% of the patients over there are terrorists. Arab terrorists. Now they bring Al-Qaeda people from Syria to Israel every day. Do you know that? Every day they bring Syrian murderers that if you give them the power, they would blow all the Jews in the world in 1 second. They get wounded in Syria, they bring them to Israel, and they take care of them. And we have to pay for it. That's what happens when you don't have Torah authority. If the government had Torah, they knew you don't save your murderers, that they come and kill you. It's against the Torah, it's not mitzvah. Eh, we're human, we're not like them. Enough with this nonsense. Even in America, they're not that dumb. You tell the Americans, let's bring Al-Qaeda, Zoheri, and Bin Laden, and his sons to New York and give them treatment in a hospital for cancer. What would happen here in America? They'll burn Obama alive. All the rednecks, they hear that they have to pay for the Arabs to come here, the terrorists, that they give them treatment in New York. Hospital, it's a catch-22. Sometimes you get lucky. You open a hospital, you sponsor it, one big righteous person come, you take care of him, you save him, now you have a big merit, you save the big rabbi. Well, what happened if Bin Laden come and you saved him and then he blow the twins and you kill 3,000 people with your money? You have no control what your money is going to do. What are you going to say to him? Hey, Muhammad, if I'll save you now, tomorrow you come and stab me in the back. You can't say it, it's against the law, democracy. I have to take care of everyone. What are you going to do? So Ben Ish Chai told him, forget about the hospital. Hospital, you have plenty of people that don't know Torah. They run with money to give for the hospital. Yeshiva! Nobody understands what it is. Nobody wants to give money. You go, and that's going to be your mitzvah. And he listened to the Ben Ish Chai, and he came to Israel, and he built an amazing, beautiful building. If you see the building, even today it's a fancy mansion. Beautiful, nice, old brick building. The best architect built that building. The old Porat Yosef before the Arab destroyed it and burned it. Then later they rebuilt them in two different places, next to the Western Wall and in Geula. Ha'ir Ha'atika, the old city, and in Shchunat Geula. It's two better Porat Yosef, but you know, the original one was one. And Chacham Ezra Atiyah later became Rosh Yeshiva, and all the Tzfaradim Rabbi, Bar Shalom, and Hades, and Ben Zion Abba Shaul, and Rav Ovadia, and Zion Cohen, and Rav Chacham Baruch from Brooklyn, those rabbis who came under his hands, each one of them became a giant. Mamash, they established big Torah yeshivot, that in Chacham Raful, a lot of them, that they came out of his hand. One day, Ezra Atiya, the big Rav, he see that the boy Ovadia is missing from yeshiva. One day, 2 days, 3 days, he said, something like this never happened. This boy cannot stop learning Torah. Something happened. He ran to his house, he asked his mother, where is Ovadia? She says, helping his father in a store. He ran to the grocery store of his father. Where is Ovadia? He see Ovadia, the boy is cutting cheese. What are you doing here? Oh, my father doesn't help. I have to help him in a store. So he came to his father. He told him, what, you taking the boy out of yeshiva? So what am I going to do? I have to eat. Nobody here to help. So he said to him, okay, send him here. I'm going to help you. Go to yeshiva. The Rosh Yeshiva, the big chacham, the genius Talmid chacham, holy person. Picked up his sleeves. You should see how they were. I have a book with pictures from 80, 90, 100 years ago, how these people used to dress. You look at them, you right away you freeze from the... You see right away you stand next to a holy person, you feel it. You look at their face, you see the love they had to Hashem, these people, you read the stories about them, you can't believe these people were people. Mamash like angels. It's like the evil inclination did not exist by them. So he went there, he started to cut cheese. Tell Rosh Yeshiva today, go to the grocery store and cut yellow cheese. Take some olive from the, you know, with the basket. Imagine what would happen to you. This insulted me. I'm the Rosh Yeshiva. He tell me go to work in a grocery store? What is this? Down to earth. Then the customer came to him. Hey, Yaakov, you normal? The biggest chacham in Yerushalayim is cutting cheese in your... What's going on with you? The people started to scream at him. He got nervous. So he let him go and he saved him. Imagine if he wouldn't take him out of the grocery store. He would destroy the boy. So why did I tell you this story? Is that they say, Rav Ben Zion say, for days we didn't have what to eat. We were learning Torah in the stomach was making all kinds of noises. For days, there's nothing to eat, nothing. You come to the kitchen, not one little stale piece of bread. Not like the poor people today. Food stamps, turkey, sushi. You know one poor person in Queens that can raise his hand and say, I never ate sushi? I never ate steak? I never ate barbecue chicken? I never ate in a restaurant? Poor! The poorest person. I don't wear a nice suit. Yeah, the house is small. Sometimes it's not enough. So they cannot go on vacation. Poor family. No vacation. Fine. The poverty of today, it's not what it was. The way people consider to be poor today, that was either middle class or high class in the old days. I always say, even the rich people, consider yourself a millionaire, 80 years ago. You have a servant, you have horses, carriage. what kind of life the millionaire 80 years ago had compared to a poor person today. Compare them one by one, and the poor person from the neighborhood here has a much better life than the sheikh of 80 years ago. Why? Toilet. No toilet paper. Think about it. What kind of life is this? No electric. You sit in a if you are, the rich people had toilet in their backyard. That was already luxury. But what kind of toilet? They build it from wood. There's a hole in the ground. There's no flushing. Marble from Italy. Mirrors cut like this, cut like that, all kinds of light, halogen lights. What kind of bathroom the rich people had? You sit there and you pray to Hashem, Shir la ma'alot, that the snake won't beat me. That's it. And the rest of the people, they go in far away, 15 minutes walk to go to the bathroom. Not like today. Okay. Everything. You want to go from one place to the other. You sit in your carriage, you have to smell the bathroom of the horse in front of you. The rich people, the poor people today, sit on a bus, air conditioned, nice, music. The life of the poor people today, it's 100 times better than the life of the millionaires. So why we suffer more than they did? Because it's all in the head. It all depends how you get used to grow up. If you grow up with complaints because you compare yourself to the rest of the people, oh, they have this and I don't have, they have this and I don't have, then you suffer. But if you did not have any rich people around you, only people that are more poor, you feel great. Psh, how lucky I am. What do you mean you're lucky? I can eat once a month chicken. Wow. Why you feel so lucky? Because they don't eat once a year chicken. It's all in the head of a person. So really the suffering is not real. Remember what I'm saying here. It's really not real. It's all depend on how you translate it. You go to Africa. Go to some rich people consider in Africa, how they live. You say, you put me here 2 days, I die here. But they feel like the luckiest people in the world. They're so happy. They're great. Wow, you tell them, hey, Konta, come, we'll take you to a different country. Oh, I'm king here. What king? A shoe shine in New York has better life than you. He doesn't want. But if you take Konta to New York to be a shoe shine, and you get him a car, and he drives in a car, what does he have in Africa? And then you say to him, okay, too bad, we have to put you back in Africa, in the jungles over there. Would he agree to go back? So what do you see? It all depends on who you're comparing yourself to. That's why there's a story about Rabbi Akiva. He was so poor. He married Rachel. Her father cut her out. And they made themselves a house from straw. Like an igloo. Instead of from ice, from straw. So every day he used to clean her hair, you know, from the straw. He lived like horses. Alphabet. He doesn't know to read and write. 4 years old, she sends him now to yeshiva for 12 years. No telephone like today. Hi, honey, how are you? How's the food? What are you doing? Nah, no text, no this, no emails, no nothing. You got married. 2 weeks later, your husband is gone for 12 years. By the time you see him, he'll come with a cane. Oh, it's you, Akiva? Think about it. He left 40. He came back 64. 64. He lived 120 years, but there was no guarantee for it when she sent him. So 24 years later he came. But in these 24 years, she was very lonely, alone. Especially when you know that a person that used to be rich and became poor suffered 100 times more than someone who grew up poor. That's why the halakha requires to help someone wealthy who lost his wealth before someone who was always poor. That's a bigger mitzvah. And to give him as much as you can of what he used to have. It's not enough just to feed him. You give him a piece of bread. He is used to ducks. He eats ducks and sushi and chicken and pizza every day. That's what you have to give him. You're laughing. That's the requirements. If he had a horse, you have to get him a horse. Why? Because it's a mental help, not physical help. To just make him eat and survive, it's mitzvah, I'm not saying no. But the real mitzvah of chesed, of reviving a person, is to revive his soul, his nefesh. Take him out of his misery, out of his depression. Give him, you know, the Gemara is full of stories like this. That one kid followed the poor people that their father just gave them big donation to see how they live. And he saw that they eat in nice china plates, they eat nice chicken. So he come back to his father and said, what is this? Well, you give them money. He said, very good. That's the way the mitzvah should be. So she saw that she doesn't have anything. So Hashem sent her Eliyahu HaNavi, ask her if she can give him some straw. So imagine a person come in a custom, an angel, Eliyahu HaNavi. Excuse me, ma'am, what's your name? Rachel. Okay, shalom. I'm very poor. Can you lend me some straw? One straw. Straw is on the floor. Why Hashem did that? This is the proof to the entire 15 minutes that I just lectured you about, that it's all in the head. Hashem saw that she's suffering from poverty so much, he wanted to cure her suffering. How did he do it? By showing her someone who doesn't even have straw. Why does it change her situation? She still has nothing to eat. She's still miserable. She's still lonely in a dark, in a house from straw. Her husband is still away. Something changed in her life? Yes. She heard that there's someone who suffers more than me. I'm lucky. It changed her mental state. Many times me, as a person who deals with the public, if, you know, life has ups and downs, when something bad happens, you feel down. You lose your energy, you're sad. And then, unfortunately, there's not 10 minutes that I don't get a call with a tragedy or problem or what happened to people and what, you know, all kinds of things like this. So I don't even have more than 10 minutes to be depressed on my own situation, ever. Because as soon as I begin to be upset, right away I get a call and someone who suffers 100 times more. So I feel right away so ashamed that I was about to be sad. When this person just called me, I don't know. I don't know what to do now. To cry for me, I have to cry 100 times more for him. So not only that you're not upset anymore, you feel, how lucky I am. Well, things that you take for granted all of a sudden have a huge value. You cry about this, you cry. If a person wants to cry about something, he will always find what to cry about. Who do you think cry more about their life? The wealthy people or the poor? Huh? Wealthy, a lot more. How do I know? I never believed that that's the case, but today I'm telling you 100%, because I speak to them, I see what's happening out there. They're never full. I know one wealthy woman, she married to a person, it worth about $100 million. It's enough, no? It's wealthy, no? They live in a $5 million house, they have two fancy cars, they have two big businesses, they own a lot of real estate, they have few maids in the house, beautiful mansion, nice pool, few acres of land, you know, everything, much like in fancy schmancy movies. You should see how this woman over there cry about her life. You're not gonna believe it. So one time, I sent her husband, and she was attached to him, to see the guys in my yeshiva in Yerushalayim, how they live. I say, I'm going to kill two birds with one stone. How do you kill two birds with one stone? You have to aim good. I say, my real goal is that this wealthy man will see how my guys are starving for bread, and they sit and learn Torah every day, and they live in a tiny bedroom with 5, 6, 7 children in a freezing Jerusalem winter. He open up his wallet. It's peanuts for him. And also, it will save his marriage. Why? Because he constantly, all the time, he complains, she killed him. I say, what's the right way to cure her? To let her see how girls living, how they live. One kid here, another one here. He's on the floor, everything broken, shower. Exactly as I planned. She called later to my wife, she said to her, I never believe I'm gonna see things like this in my whole life. How then, how these women are such heroes? For maybe a few months, she never made a complaint. But then you know how it is. The Yetzer Hara made her forget. And everything started to come back again. But for a few months, he had a peace of mind. Because she was so ashamed that she was even complaining after what she saw. So you see, it's all in the head. Take the wealthiest person in a town, the chief. Move him to another town that people are wealthier than him. Right away, he loses his desire to live. What happened, Moshe? You take Prozac. I just discovered that I'm so poor. Up to yesterday, he felt he's the effendi of the town. Now, he's nothing. You understand? This is what life is all about. That's why the Torah says, Ezeh wa ashir, asameach b'chelko. Who is rich? Someone who is happy with what Hashem gives him, whether it's a lot, whether it's not, doesn't matter. Anyway, life here is a blink of the eye. To start complaining, crying about my situation. I'm married, I'm not married, I have food, I don't have food, I can afford, I cannot afford, I'm healthy, I'm not healthy. Everything is important. Bottom line, when you move to the next world, do they ask you if you were healthy or not? They ask you if you're a great musician or not, if you're handsome or not, if you're pretty or not, if you have millions or you have nothing. Nobody asks this question. They only ask one thing. You have Torah and Yirat Shamayim. Two things. Righteousness, fear from God, faith, etc. This is all Yirat Shamayim. And Torah. Let's see your basket. How much it weighs. A person has to stand there, what is it, 200 days, Rabbi? 200 days, when a person died, 200 days straight to say Divrei Torah? I saw a midrash. A person has to stand, if I remember correctly, 200 days straight and say words of Torah. 200 days. The good news is over there you have no forgetting. Can't forget. Whatever you ever learn, you remember. You ever learn, you remember. Over here, you learn. Here, after this lecture. I can test you now. If I ask, anyone here can raise his hand and repeat 10% of what I say in the last hour and a half? 10%! Which means an hour and a half is 90 minutes. You have to give me a 9-minute speech to consume this lecture. Summary. Usually people don't remember even 2 minutes. That's why I always say, all the lectures is all nonsense. It doesn't really matter what you say. There's only one reason for the lecture. And if not, you're a worthless speaker. The only reason to make a lecture is not for the 2 hours or 1 hour knowledge that you learn. Yeah, if you go on the video a few times, then you learn. You need 4 or 5 times until you remember all the details. There's only one thing you want to achieve in a lecture. That the people came to the lecture happy, relax, life is beautiful, they live in a dream, when they're heading direct, express to the worst place in their afterlife, finally they got shaken up. You woke them up from their dream, from their illusion, and you put some fear in their heart, maybe I live in mistake. That's what you want to achieve in a lecture. To shake the heart. 2 minutes. You can speak an hour, stories, jokes, whatever. 2-3 minutes. A person had fear in his heart. Wow, he's talking about me. I'm the loser he's talking about. I'm the person who has millions and I'm never happy. I'm the person who always cheat. I'm the person who always steal. Whatever the speaker speaks about. He wake up the person from his dream. Because remember, we all have Yetzer Hara. We all fall into these dreams. Sweet dreams. A person woke up. 5 minutes, it can give him a push. If not, beautiful, it's like he went to a movie. Lectures, in a way, it's like a movie. Stories, this, nah. The question is, did the heart wake up or no? There's two ways to wake up the person from his dream. The long way and the short way. It's like a chicken, like a rooster. A rooster was in the mud, full of sand. If you want to clean the feathers now, I'll take you here. Take a little brush, go inside like this. What do you do? He shake 1 second, all the dust in 1 second is gone. You make him to shake, give him a pinch, kick him. Give him such a kick. What happened? All that, beautiful. 1 minute became tzaddik, clean. Chatayachem kashelek yalbinu. Your sins became white, pure like the snow. Why? The feathers were all white, but dirty, full of dirt. You shake the bird, right away. It's two ways. Which way you want? You want to waste years, or you want to wake up in a second? The only way to wake up, I have a student, Biton his name. Grew up in Florida. His parents, Israelis, but he is an American boy. He grew up in America. Not religious. Okay. One day someone told him, do you want to volunteer in Florida in Chevrat Kadisha? He said, what is this? He told him, you wash the dead bodies. After they die, you take some buckets, you spill some water on the body, purify the body before burial. He's such a nice person. His parents did a good job. They gave him great manners, but no religion at all. But since he's a very good heart person with great manners, it's easy to talk sense to a person with decency and discipline. So he said, okay, he agreed to volunteer. So they took him, and they brought a body in the middle of the night, someone who died. And tomorrow morning is the funeral. And it happened to be the richest Jew in Florida or something like that. The next day, all the Rolls Royce came to the funeral, all the important people. So he said to me, when he became my student, he came to the yeshiva. I used to teach Gemara in those days in the yeshiva. So he came to my class. So I said to him, hi, you from Florida, you became religious. He said, I volunteer to wash bodies. And then when this rich person was laying in a bed, I started to think to myself, look at the end of the people. This billionaire got a heart attack. He's laying here on a bed. I have to wash him like a dog. He's thinking to himself, look how I wash him like an animal. So it got me to think. And then one thing leads to another. That 1 hour was enough shock for him. You should see what a tzaddik this person is. If you need a bracha from someone, only is the guy. What an amazing person. Torah, manners, mamash perfect person. The man, perfect person. Cannot find one bad thing about him. Great personality. Never hurt a person. Hardworking guy. Always quiet. Never interfere with people's business. Mamash, live holy life. What saved him? Going to wash the body of someone. Imagine if he wouldn't volunteer. Still be in Florida in some college. Died like a goy with nothing. And Hashem had mercy on him. He gave him an opportunity to wake up. That's what the Gemara say, by the way. If a person has his Yetzer Hara attacking him, Moshcheu lebet ha-midrash, pull him right away to the yeshiva. You're on the way to a soccer game. Championship, Rabbi! Championship once a year! The World Cup! Woo, you know, I'm waiting months for it. It's his life. What's going to happen? One thing leads to another. You forget about who you are. Right away, run to yeshiva for an hour on your way to the game. The yeshiva will cool you off. If it didn't happen, didn't help, the Gemara gives few recommendations. And what's the last one? If everything still did not help, Yazkir le'atzmo yom amita. Remember that the worms and the snakes will bite and eat your snake just like a dead rat. That's going to be your end. Remember that. There's other ways, other recommendations. Remember where you came from. Where you came from? From a drop of liquid. That's what you really are. Okay. If you're still proud and you have arrogance and ego, look at yourself. You're like an animal. You eat, you go to the bathroom, these, all these things that you do, just like a chimpanzee. What's better? Still doesn't help. Remember that the worms would eat you in a grave. There's things that can help a person right away comes right down from the tree he climbed with his ego and pride. There's a list of recommendations. This guy, he got lucky. He remembered the day of death. He saw how a person is laying there. You know, one time, there was two guys from Chevrat Kadisha in Israel came to Monsi. They stayed at the house of Rabbi Aderet in Monsi. It's one block, two blocks away from my home. So they stayed there by Shabbat. So they're talking about things that happened. So he asked them, tell us about interesting things from your work. You're dealing with burial of bodies, funerals. So they said that one time there was a Reformed Jew from Germany, somewhere in Europe, and a Reformed Jew died over there, and they want to bury his body, his family in Israel. So they're sending his body in a sealed coffin with the airplanes to Israel, and the Chevrat Kadisha have to accept it and do the funeral. When the body arrived, he's in sealed box, sealed vacuum. You know that he won't smell and it's not going to get rotten. It's only 3-4 hours flight. All the driving and arrangements and until you take it to the Chevrat, it's about 10 hours journey from the time they wrapped him until they get to the grave. So the family in Israel were arguing. Some of them are not religious at all. Some of them have some tradition. So they're arguing if to do tahara to the body, if to purify the body with water. Some say, just bury it like this. Some say, no, let's do it. They're arguing. In the end, the sides that want to purify the body won. So they had to open it. So they took it to a quiet room. They opened it, and they found a huge, thick snake inside the box. And half of his face was already eaten. Half, no eye, no, half, all the cheek, all the side, it's already whole, big hole full of blood. So they called up Chevrat Kadisha in Germany, screaming, what's going on here? What, you're sending here a body with a snake inside? So all the rabbis over there said, what are you talking about? What snake? We ourselves, all of us closed the box, there was nothing there, just the body. Nobody understand where the snake come from. Half of him was eaten already, before he was even buried. But in the time of the Chazon Ish, there's a cemetery in Bnei Brak. They took one person to bury him in late evening. They come to take the body down to the grave. They see a big snake inside the grave waiting like this with his face up. Somebody, and there was no telephones, somebody ran all the way to the house of the Chazon Ish to ask him what to do. I don't know. The Chazon Ish say, go to a different grave. Bury him in a different grave, clean the grave, and bury somebody else there. They came to a different grave, they're about to put him in, another snake inside. Two snakes, two graves available, both of them have a snake inside. Again, he runs to the house of the Chazon Ish say, bury him. That's what Hashem wants for him. So he said they put the body down, the snake jumped on him like this. This is it. This is the word of the Zohar and the Gemara. The soul never stops suffering until the worms finish to eat the entire body. The heavier a person is, the longer the soul suffers. And it's not a joke. Better to do a good diet before we die. Yes. Why? That's why we see a cancer patient, we feel horrible for him. He become shrink. He was, I don't know, 200 pounds, 180, 160, he became in the end 80 pounds. Oh, what a suffering this person had for 1 year, chemo, that doesn't eat. Look at him, wow, I'm shocked. I can't recognize my uncle. In reality, this is the luckiest person that you can imagine. For two reasons. One, the length of the suffering until the worms finished to eat the body was cut maybe by who knows what, by 8 months. The Zohar say every bite they take, the soul suffer. The soul still connected to the nefesh in a grave. But there is something even better. What is it? That a person that suffer X amount of time before he died, then we know for sure that Hashem had mercy on him. And he cleaned him from his sins in this world. Otherwise, over there, everything is very, very long and very, very serious punishments. If you see a person suffer here, 6 months, 1 year, hospitals, doctors, surgery, in and out. Even you look at the Gemara, say Rabbi Akiva came to, what is it, Rabbi Eliezer HaGadol. Rabbi Akiva saw that the biggest chacham in Israel is became sick. So all the chachamim were crying, the chief rabbi is suffering in bed. And Rabbi Akiva was laughing, happy. So they said to him, Akiva, what's wrong with you? The chief rabbi of Israel is suffering like these sicknesses, and you are happy? In front of the chief rabbi, he said, Rabbi, until now, I was worried if you have a share to the world to come. Everything in your life was too perfect. No sicknesses, no money losses, family, children, Torah, honor. It was too easy. Now when I see before you leave us, Hashem is giving you suffering, I'm very happy for you. Because I know now Hashem is cleaning from the lid. Everyone does something not perfect. We're not angels, yeah. Same thing, Chacham Ovadia. The last 2-3 months suffered a lot. It started, in my opinion, it started when the Reshaim, the wicked government of Israel, decided to take all the Bachurei Yeshiva to the army. He took it very hard to his heart. Mamash, he was crying over it day and night, screaming. You should see in some of his lecture, the voice couldn't come out of his mouth. Mamash was very depressed from it. Because how much he loved Torah, someone whose life is Torah, to take tens of thousands of serious tzaddikim who sits all day and learn Torah and make them lose their soldiers that don't know even how to hold a gun and burn their life and their time, and the army doesn't even need them. It's a burden for the army. The army doesn't need them. It's all just on purpose to destroy the Torah. He took it very hard to his heart. That was the beginning of his sicknesses. Because when a person is depressed, his immune system don't work. You should know it. Right away he becomes sick. Right away, if you're depressed, sad, the chances to be sick is hundreds of percent higher, especially when you're 90. So he started to go into the hospital in and out. Before that, didn't go to the hospital. From one little infection, he had an infection somewhere in the back. He went to the kidney, the kidney stopped to work, then it started to affect the heart. One thing leads to another. In and out of the hospital, the antibiotic didn't work. They put a pacemaker in his heart. In, out, lots of suffering. He came out of the hospital. One time he came out of the hospital in the morning, in the afternoon he hospitalized again. You think about it, you check out a person in this age. Why is it? Why a tzaddik like this who gave his life for the Torah and for Hashem? Because everyone is doing 1, 2, 3 things that is not 100% perfect. In 93 years, cannot say everything I did was perfect. We're not angels. Moshe Rabbeinu, the Gemara brings some things that he did not 100%. He got punished for it. You see, David HaMelech, Shlomo HaMelech, the legendary people, Rabbi Akiva. So also Chacham Ovadia. So, but Hashem cleaned him. 1 month, 2 months of suffering, 3 months, whatever, to clean from the little for the 1% things that still needs to be corrected, that it can go to the highest level. We, however, if we be lucky, we'll get clean in a month or two. Some of us need 1 or 2 million years to get clean. Depend who we are. Think about it. If you're really honest with yourself, and you evaluate your everyday life, your schedule, how much Torah you learn, how modest you are, how generous you are, how you care about other people, and everything else in our life. You evaluate yourself page by page according to the Shulchan Aruch. I promise you, you run to the Empire State Building and you crush yourself into the streets from depression. If you're really honest, sometimes it's good not to be too honest. If we'd be too honest, we wouldn't be able to live with our sins. The fact that we lie to ourselves every day keeps us going. Otherwise, if a person would be honest, look at me. Rabbeinu Nissim, 700-800 years ago. What did he write in a confession? If I come to reveal my sin, the time in this world will end, and the least will not end. And I give my life on it that he did not make one sin in his life. Not two, one. Why? How can you make sin when all your life you learn nonstop? Where can you make sins? You cannot disconnect from the Torah a minute. All your life, Torah, poverty, Yirat Shamayim, love to Hashem, praying, modest life, simple life, Torah, teaching, learning. What can go wrong? And he wrote, if I will come to mention my sins, the time in this world will end, thousands of years of, and I still won't finish the list. So what are we going to say? What are we going to say? If people in the level of Rashi or Rambam, that's the way they thought about themselves. No stories. Not like today. Every loser pretend he's humbled. Come like this with the books, pretend he's the Baba Sali. No. These people were not fakers. Believe me, I promise you, if he wrote in his Siddur, confession, Hashem, if I come to reveal my sins, the time will end and I still won't finish the list. This is what he felt. Moshe Rabbeinu, Hashem opened him the gate of hell and he saw thousands of people are screaming and burning. The Zohar says started to shake. That's why in the Torah in Monday, in the second day, it doesn't say Vayar Hashem Kitov. On Tuesday, it says Pa'amayim Kitov, twice. One for Monday. But in the end of the creation of the second day, it doesn't say Hashem saw it's good, what he created. Why? The Kabbalah explained, how can you write good when Hashem created Gehenom? Cannot write good. Echel Moshe Roed. Moshe started to shake. Moshe Rabbeinu, Hashem told him already, I love you, you're my son. You're the most humble person in history. My Torah is named the Torah of Moshe. You are the most legendary people in history. And he saw what happened in Auschwitz, and he started to scream and to shake. Today, I'm a tzaddik. I'm the biggest tzaddik. You know how many zchuyot I have? How do you dare talking to me? Everyone thinks this is Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. The key to succeed in life is to first recognize our sicknesses. If you recognize what you're seeking, there is a chance to get cured. If you don't see your sickness, there's not even a chance to cure yourself. You know what medication to take if you don't know what you're sick. A person doesn't know he has a sickness. Fatigue, this, that. One day fall and die. What happened? He did not diagnose his sickness. If he did, he will get cured. In a pharmacy, $5 medicine and cure him. Like they have aspirin, this, it saves from heart attack. All kinds of cholesterol pills, whatever. The idea is first to know what I'm sick. If a person doesn't think he's proud, I'm proud, I'm the most humble guy. He doesn't see his angry wolf. I'm angry, I'm only angry when people get me angry. Of course, you fool. Who's angry when no one talks to him? Gets up, is alone in his room, and he bangs his head to the wall. Moshe, what are you doing over there? Of course. Well, you know, you saw ever a person get angry out of nowhere? He wakes up in the morning. Yesterday was a perfect day. He got up today. He's alone all day in the room, and he hit the walls, and he bangs his head to the wall, and he screams, he cares, he breaks the chair. Why? No one was there. Somebody like this needs a mental institution. Of course you get angry if someone gets you angry, but there's no permission. And all the rest of the sicknesses. I have a whole pathogen series. Not me, Ramchal. It's Ramchal. I just brought it to a simple language for the people to understand. He writes about the sicknesses of the soul, of the person in this world. Be'ezrat Hashem, we'll see you next Monday. The Shavua cannot be good, but as much as he can, Be'ezrat Hashem, Hashem have mercy on us. Baruch Adonai L'olam. Amen.